Yeah, sure. I'm not trying to make anybody famous. I'm just trying to get the information.
We can actually send you the presentation.
Yeah, you'll get much better quality off of the PowerPoint than you will off of this. But that's kind of up to you.
Okay. Fair enough.
Okay. So real briefly.
I took it out of your head. Discussion.
Okay. Hi, everybody. So thanks for coming here. I think most of you know me. I'm Stephen Nessel. I published SaveMarinwood.org. Reason for tonight's meeting is just to learn from... I'm sorry, I forget the alphabet soup name of your organization.
Regional Water Quality Control Board.
Okay.
An agency in the state of California.
So the reason for tonight's meeting is simply to understand the science of the toxic waste spill and to just have them explain to us what's going on. This is not about the merits of the Marinwood Plaza development or the Marinwood Village development, so we will have no questions on that. So please respect that. They're just trying to provide us with good quality information. Okay, and with that, you have the meeting. Here's Mary Rose.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Mary Rose Massa. I'm Supervisor, Senior Engineering Geologist in the Regional Water Quality Control Board. Our office is in Oakland. Ken Powell on the side here is the project manager.
All right.
And I guess after I'm supposed to review the meeting, the scope, format, and ground rules, and then we'll do some introductions. So Stephen did a nice job of the scope of the meeting. We're here to talk about the contamination at Marinwood Plaza. We want to help you learn a little bit more about the Regional Water Board's regulatory process and give you a chance to ask questions and obtain clarification about the investigation activities and some of the interim cleanup that's been completed, and maybe hear something about some future cleanup proposals. And then we want to get your input regarding future community involvement. And in your package, you have an evaluation form. You can use that form to tell us what you think of the meeting, to tell us what you think about future meetings. If you have questions that you're too shy to ask, you can write the question down. And if you want to get an answer, you'll have to tell us who you are on the form. So, I have a list of proposed ground rules that are just basically common courtesy for a public meeting and a community meeting. I'd like to ask you to turn off your cell phones. Only one person will speak at a time, and try not to interrupt when someone else is speaking. We'll try to stay on track with the agenda. We think we've left some time in the beginning of the meeting to tell you the science and the regulatory process, and then we think we've left a lot of time at the end to entertain your questions. Feel free to stop the speaker if you need to ask a clarifying question. We'd like you to just express your own views when you're speaking and try to avoid prolonged comments so that other people have a chance to speak. And then focus on the merits of what's being said and make a good faith effort to understand the concerns of others. And I'm going to try to facilitate the meeting, and I'll try to keep things on schedule. If it looks like we're going to run out of time, I'll make proposals for handle that situation. So I think now is the time for the 7:20 part of the meeting, which is brief introductions. Ken, do you want to start?
So my name is Ken Allen. I'm a licensed hydrogeologist, and I work at the Regional Water Quality Control Board in the Toxics Cleanup Division. I began as a case manager for this particular case last November. Previously, I was a consultant for many years, and I worked on the investigation cleanup at the PG&E Manchester Gas Plant in San Miguel and Hamilton Airfield. I'm a resident of the county and I live right over Big Rock Ridge.
My name is Uta Hermann Blumberg. I'm a toxicologist at the Water Board and Marinwood there over a year. And my main job is to evaluate the health risk of contamination. My background is cancer research, and I got here to do this case.
Thank you. I'm Stephen Hill. I'm head of the Toxics Cleanup Division at the Water Board, and I've been with the Water Board for a little over 25 years.
Wow.
Now, Dan?
Yeah, the guy. I'm Dan Matthews, a geologist with an environmental consulting company called Geologica, and I've been working on the Marinwood Plaza investigation cleanup for the last 5 years, and I've done most of the work and report writing. So I'm going to give a little overview today after we go through our discussion process, and I'll be open to questions.
Okay, so I won't take long, but I'd just like to tell you a little bit about what the Water Board does with respect to cleanup. We oversee about 3,000 cleanup sites in the Bay Area, including a number of dry cleaner spill sites. And here in Marin County, we oversee about 500 cleanup cases and about 10 dry cleaner spill sites. For background, California and in most states, in fact, follow what's called a polluter pays approach. So the costs of cleanup are borne by responsible parties and not by the public at large. And how that works is that we, as the regulatory agency, direct investigation and cleanup work, and we set cleanup levels using our California Water Code Authority. And then the responsible parties, for their part, propose specific measures. They actually perform the work after we've approved it, and they submit technical reports to document that work. We, as a state agency, can't specify the means of compliance, but we can and do require cleanup that's protective of human health and the environment. At the end of the process, for any given site, we'll close the case to signify that cleanup is complete and no further action is required. Do I see a question? As part of this process, we circulate key documents, such as draft cleanup plans, to interested persons, and we provide an opportunity for comments. And interested persons might include other agencies, people who live in the neighborhood, landowners, things like that. We post key documents to Geotracker, and that's an online database that is accessible to the public. We'll tell you a bit more about that later on if you don't already know about that. So if you go to the Geotracker page for this site, you'll see a site summary. You'll see two fact sheets, various directive letters that we've sent, and various technical reports submitted by the responsible parties. That's really all I wanted to cover in this. Quick question. So I'll pass it back to Andrew Rose and just Dan Gay.
Getting that that rigged up. The packet that will be handed out, if you go to the back of the fact sheet, which is the fourth page, there's a link to Geotracker. And so you can.
We can't hear you, really.
Okay. If you go to the fourth page of the fact sheet, at the bottom, there's a link to Geotracker. Link to Geotracker on the fourth page of the fact sheet.
I introduce myself. I'm going to talk about the former Prosperity Cleaners in the Marinwood Plaza Shopping Center. I don't know if all of you know where the dry cleaner was located in the strip mall there. It's a couple doors down from the Save More Liquor Store and a little bit from the Marinwood Market. That dry cleaner was there probably from when the shopping mall was built in 1965, and it operated as a dry cleaner until December 2009, when we asked them to leave so that we could do some cleanup work inside the dry cleaner. They used a solvent called perchloroethylene to clean clothes, also known as PERC or PCE. It's a great solvent, good for removing stains, and it's also been problematic for.
Yeah,
everyone hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. It's also been problematic for environmental cleanup activities. So they stopped using that in 2005 and started shipping their clothes offsite for cleaning. That use was regulated by the State Air Board and by the County Health Department, and no violations were found or reported in the record. But this dry cleaner dates from the 60s, and we found that many dry cleaners from that time period had problems. Part of it was just the standard of care, how they handled things. It was not intentional on the part of the dry cleaner, and certainly not intentional on the part of the property owner in the plaza. So in 2007, there was an initial investigation by a prospective buyer. That deal didn't go through, but they found some PCE and related compounds that we call volatile organic chemicals, VOCs, in the soil and groundwater, and that prompted additional work where Geologica got involved then. And then in January 2008, we recommended that the property owner, Marinwood Plaza, get into an oversight agreement with the regional board for investigation and cleanup so that the work would proceed in a orderly fashion with the regional board reviewing our work plans and reviewing our reports and making sure that we're doing everything that should be done. Wanted to give you a little bit of a overview of what is it about dry cleaning solvent when you spill it that is so problematic for us. And it's, the basic problem is that because it's a volatile compound, when it gets into the ground, a lot of it sticks to the soil, but part of it also spreads out into the spaces between soil particles, which we call that soil vapor. It's basically just air. And then down below, where rain has infiltrated into the ground, we have groundwater, this dry cleaning solvent also dissolves into the groundwater. So whenever we look at a dry cleaner site, we're looking at three different things. We're looking at soil vapor, and then the groundwater. So it complicates the investigation. It also factors into the cleanup. And then a factor here is that this is a snapshot, but this doesn't happen instantly. This is the end result of decades of slow movement in the ground. And what you have left here is that blue, where the area where the stuff is stuck to the soil, that continues to exude dry cleaning solvent for a long period of time. So our first step, typically, when we're investigating, is to find that spot, and on the cleanup side, is to remove it or treat it or do something to make that area with the soil is in fact to go away. And then generally the rest of it will follow along. So let me go on to the work that's been done. Initial investigation work is in 2007. In November, we installed groundwater monitor wells to confirm that initial work. We found PCE and these dry cleaning solvents in the groundwater, so we knew we had a release. And that's why we recommended to the owners to talk to the board. Then we put together a work plan in March 2008 to investigate the conditions more comprehensively and thoroughly. And in October, we came out and we did sampling for all those different media, the soil, the soil gas, and the groundwater. I think some of our posters show that we did a lot of borings in the ground. We collected a lot of samples. There's been a lot of work done there to try to figure out what's going on. And what we found, which spreads out into the three media again, but in soil, two areas. One, pretty much right under the dry cleaning machine. There was a drain in the forenail of the machine, so it kind of makes sense. That's where things would leak out. And then another area back here, this is on the back side of the dry cleaner, east of the dry cleaner, and up against the on-ramp with southbound 101, where we don't know what happened there. Maybe somebody was cleaning filters from the dry cleaning machine. Maybe if they spilled something, they dumped it out there. We don't know. That's ancient history, and that dry cleaner left about four dry cleaners ago. So we've never been able to piece together what happened, but there's another hot spot there with where there is PC and the dry cleaning solids stuck in the soil. So those are two areas we're concerned about.
Yeah. Is that a fairly common scenario with dry cleaners to have a hot spot inside the building and another one outside? Perhaps the board can answer that.
Yes. Yeah, more common than not.
Yeah. Sometimes things move along the sewer line, because when they maybe mop the floor, goes down the drain. The 1960s era sewer pipes were tile pipes or cement pipes, and every one of those little joints leaks a little bit. So we looked along the sewer line. That was part of the 2008 investigation.
So the dry cleaning machines, what happened to the waste? Would it go into the sewer system, or was that
majority of the waste was shipped off-site. Even okay. As far back as 1965, they would have had Dow bring in a drum of fresh solvent and another at a waste hauler hallway, the dirty solvent. But there's always a little spill when you're taking stuff out of the right. machine. It's mainly little stuff. We can get a rough sense of the scale of things from our investigation. It's not more than a few pounds of dry cleaning stuff. It's not like somebody took a truckload over there and just dumped it on the ground. So this doesn't show up so well in these colors, but in the soil vapor, you tend to see it spread out a bit. We had in the soil just the dry cleaning machine in this area in the back, but in the soil vapor, things tend to spread out. And that's a concern because, go ahead.
Oh, you can finish your
Okay. Story. That's a concern because in soil vapor, this stuff moves in all directions, up, sideways, and in particular, we found that it moved into the liquor store. It goes up through cracks in the floor. So I'll talk about it later, but one of the things we did was take measures to stop that.
So that plume is, I'm sorry.
My question is next.
Go ahead.
My question is, what was the area of the initial sampling? I mean, I go to Marinwood Market all the time, that's why I'm here, and so I'm just wondering, did the sampling go to Marinwood Market and you didn't find anything, or at all? What was the range?
If you take a look at this drawing over here, yeah. You can see all the samples that were collected. There's another example, yeah. There's another copy of that.
There was a sample near the market?
Yeah.
Two samples near the market, there's a sample over here. These samples were taken for the gas station. So we're pretty confident that it hasn't spread towards the market. I think one of the things Dan hasn't pointed out is that vapor plume that he's showing is also coming from the groundwater. Once it gets into the groundwater moves.
Okay, so I'm looking at the field, that cross-hatched field, and I'm looking at the data collection sites. Am I correct? This is just conjecture on your part that would be the most likely field of pollution?
We could get a better reading on it if you did 10, 20, 30 more explorations. So this is based on 27 explorations.
Oh, okay.
For soil vapor.
I mean, and it doesn't, it seems to be pretty contained. That's.
We got it. This is a clean sample here. There's a well here now at about this location that's clean. This sample was clean. That had a little bit that's migration along the sewer pipe. There is a location back of the store. So, yeah, we're pretty comfortable that we've got that identified. And we have monitored wells in place now that we monitor periodically to continue to check that. Who's next? Between you.
I am a owner resident of Casa Marinwood and it's across the street.
Yes, over here.
And
on this side?
I observed that I don't see any kind of steps taken in that side.
We have samples here, here. There's been several samples out here under the trees on the edge of the parking lot.
Can you talk about the direction that it would travel? That might help clear things up. That it would travel towards the bay because that's the direction that the groundwater is usually flowing.
Well, as Mary Rose said, that the soil vapor plume here is, mainly following the groundwater plume, which is heading in an easterly or southeasterly direction towards San Francisco Bay. And these edges here are defined by clean samples. So we're pretty comfortable. It's not moving west towards the houses, north towards Willow Creek Road, or south. I'll come back to you.
Okay, that's fine.
There's a new hand back there.
Just FYI, there was a dry cleaner there back as far as November 1963.
63?
Mm-hmm. Because my mom learned about the Kennedy assassination through the dry cleaner's lady.
Okay. Conspiracy theory.
So the soil, oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I think one more question here, and then we'll go back there.
Yeah, soil sampling, your hash marks there, has there been anything done on the eastern side of the freeway in the Silvera areas?
Not yet. That's next up. Okay, we'll come to that.
Can I make a suggestion? Some of the questions you're asking are things that he's going to get to later, and so okay. It might be better if we save, you know, just the clarification questions down, just hang on a bit and see if your question's not answered, and scribble it on a piece of paper or something.
That's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. I've only got a couple more slides, and then we can circle back for questions. Okay. So we talked about soil vapor, groundwater. The concern with groundwater, of course, is we all rely on drinking water. We collected a number of samples around the dry cleaner, across the on-ramp here, along the edge of the property on the west side, to look for this dry cleaning solvent in the groundwater, and it's pretty much limited to this area to the east of the dry cleaning machine in that area by the fence. And all indications are is that it's moving east or southeasterly. We continue to monitor that. We can evaluate the groundwater flow direction and it's consistently to the east. We have discussed with the regional board doing more work farther east because we haven't really closed the east end of this shaded area, and that's something that will be done this year. Then, to summarize our initial findings.
I just have a question to clarify the prior chart. When you say that's groundwater, it's because we drink water, the water that people drink around here comes from Marinwood Plaza water.
Right. The water that everyone in this area is using is coming from the Marin Municipal Water District. Their water supply is surface water reservoirs and wells far away from here. This is more of an evaluation of if you put a well here, would you be able to drink the water? And the answer is you wouldn't want to deal with it in this blue shaded zone. But otherwise, it's good. So to summarize, we found the dry clean solvent in soil in two areas. We see some easterly migration of this solvent in soil vapor and groundwater, but it's very limited to the northwest and south, and that's a At least some good news on the investigation, since most of the residences are northwest of this settlement site. The next steps we have planned are to conduct an off-site groundwater investigation. You'll see us drilling on the east side of Highway 101, probably within the next month. We're going to do more sampling in that eastern hotspot area to test how we have started some cleanup actions here and completed some things. We had an intrusion problem with this vapor getting up into the liquor store. We've addressed that by sealing the floor to seal the cracks and also putting ventilation fans that blow clean air into the building. We've done treatment of the soil in the two areas with an oxidizer injection, which is the Clorox is an oxidizer. We use an industrial strength oxidizer that we inject into the ground that breaks down this dry cleaning solvent. And then we followed that with a bioremediation injection treatment in 2011. That's where you add it's a thick viscous liquid that is food for the bacteria that are naturally present in the soil that can break down this dry cleaning solvent. So if we give them more food, grow up the population, they break down that solvent, and we've been seeing some decreases in the concentrations in the soil vapor and groundwater. And we're going to go back out later this year and test the soil to see how effective that treatment has been. And then we'll continue to monitor.
So what is the time that with this current treatment, how long will it take to get to the lower level?
With the biotreatment program we have in place, that's typically a 3 to 5 year process. And when we started this, the commercial property market was in a slump and it didn't look like the property was going to go anywhere for a long time. So that's a lower cost thing to do. Now that there's a prospective buyer on the scene, we're looking at speeding up the process, and that's where we'll do some more sampling later this year and look at, do we need to dig out the soil, do we need to treat it more, whatever, to speed it up. But that's the plan, is to get it going faster. How's my time? Let me.
I'll keep going.
Okay. Question?
I have a quick question on it. Would the sparging with the ozone do anything to benefit or speed up the process?
That's an option.
May limit to what the chemicals is that you've got in the ground.
Yeah, ozone works on dry cleaning solvent. That's an option. There are a number of options. It's first a question of seeing what we have left to treat, because the biotreatment we expect has been fairly effective on the soil, and we'll have to determine what needs to be treated and then look at different options for doing that. Sometimes just digging it out is the fastest way to do it, because ozone treatment takes time too. Time is money.
So going back to the field that you chosen there, how deep does it go? And I'm just trying to get a sense of the three dimensions of the plume.
I don't have a graphic for that.
Okay.
But in 2008, we did an investigation with a piece of equipment called a membrane interface probe. And you push it down into the ground, and it has a port at the tip that sucks a little bit of air up out of the ground and into an instrument on the surface. And we can see this dry cleaning solvent. We pushed that down in, I believe, 10 locations to up to 50-foot depth, and we came out of it at about 35 feet. So it's not to say this chemical can't go deeper under certain conditions, but at least in the area that we looked behind the dry cleaner, which is the direction of groundwater flow, it didn't seem to be going below 35 feet.
What's the depth of first encounter of groundwater?
Typically 20 feet. Drilling is generally a fine grain material at the surface, and then you transition into some silty sands, and that's where the water bearing zone is. In the winter, the water table does come up to within 5 feet of ground surface. So it's pretty variable.
Does it fall below the groundwater level?
Does the solvent fall below them?
Yeah. Is there a natural barrier, or does the solvent just keeps going until it hits an impermeable surface?
Well, the barrier here would be bedrock. But it's more a matter of how much solvent you have and what the groundwater gradients are in the area. And if you have a downward gradient and a whole bunch of this product, yes, it can go deeper. It doesn't seem like we have that much of a release here to drive a downward, extensive downward movement. There are plenty of sites where that has been a problem because either a lot was dumped in the ground or there's some local condition that encourages downward movement.
Thank you. I just had two questions. One is, you said initially you had anticipated a 3 to 5 year process. When did that process begin?
2011 was when we started the biotreatment.
So we're about halfway through at this point. And my second question is the whole process paid for by a property owner, or is any part of it part of tax taken out of taxes?
The thing about dry cleaner sites is that most of those dry cleaners are in a little strip mall. The dry cleaners, they're gone. So the property owner is responsible for the cleanup. This state doesn't have a dry cleaner cleanup fund. Oregon does. It's difficult to put something like that together, but basically this is all on the property owner. Two back here. Who wants?
So near a ranch across the way, do you know if they have any wells that they utilize in there to feed their cattle with?
They do have one well on the property that I'm aware of, and I understand they use it for all purposes. We asked them for permission to sample, and they declined.
We can speak to that. Why don't we go to the next slide?
Okay. So. Yeah,
here we go.
Okay, so that well, I don't know if I can improve the. This is our well is down here in the lower right corner across Miller Creek. And we are going to do 7 investigations on the east side of the freeway within the next 2 months. If we find this dry cleaning solvent there, then we'll be talking about going further east. But at this point, Sobera said, until you show me you've got something on the east side of the freeway, I don't want my well sampled. So they can do that.
I've had several conversations with Renee Sobera.
Can you speak up, please?
I've had several conversations with Renee Sobera, and she spoke up to the mother. And we've urged them to allow consult with the property owner, Dan Geologica, to let them sample her well, and she's refused. If we, as Dan pointed out, if we come up with significant concentrations of dry cleaning fluid in these locations that are mapped out here, then we at some point may use our authority, if she's not cooperative, to get onto the property and sample the well. We know that it's being used, as Dan said, for all purposes. There's a number of residences there. They're drinking from the well. And they're also using it for their dairy operations. So, does that answer the question?
Yeah.
Yeah, follow up to that. But what is the potential for the cattle drinking it, getting into the milk, coming out of humans? Is there, has it been diluted enough through, what's the humanness over all these years?
Our toxicologist is actually a human toxicologist.
And I'm a cat guy, not a cow guy.
I'm Renee Sobera. Just so everybody can put this in the bed, we tested our well, and it's clean. Okay. So we tested our well, it's our private property, and we wanted the testing to be demonstrated outside of our property line. We tested inside ourselves. We have private property. We have enough intrusion of all sorts on our property. So this is, I don't want any more spin going on in this room. We refuse to have the Corps come in or the Regional Water Control come in to do at this point because you didn't demonstrate to us that it was on our property. We chose to test it ourselves.
And so there was no problem with that well. Just so everybody in this room knows, and there's no spin about our cows and our milk. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So,
Renee, we'd like to get those results from you and look at the protocol that was used for sampling.
It's accredited. It's completely, exactly.
Would you forward that to us, please?
Exactly. We'll talk after the meeting.
Okay.
I don't particularly like how this was addressed and being refused and this and that. There's a certain innuendo with that, sure.
Well, I think we've made a strong case that there's a potential for that. We've seen other sites like this with similar concentrations of groundwater and similar geologic conditions where the contaminants have gone as far as half a mile. So
as a public agency,
we have to be very cautious about that. So.
But it's not the first time that a property owner would choose to do their testing, right? Correct? I mean, we're not the first. So I'm just a little appalled that wasn't mentioned. Perhaps that property owner did their own testing.
We were totally unaware of that. That's the first we've heard of.
But I mean, it's a possibility. So today we just heard refused.
Sir.
Yes. Thank you. I'm just, after hearing all of this and then reviewing some of the information about the toxic pollution and everything, I wonder, since this thing has been recognized.
We'll get your mic here.
Since this has been recognized, I think even on your records, as January of 1970, that it was identified as a site, and if that is still correct, why is it taking this long to finally get the thing cleaned up? Why hasn't some public agency, I don't care, the county, the state, somebody, taken action to pursue getting this thing cleaned up, sooner? Because, I mean, as you stated, that the longer this stuff is in the ground, it continues to spread and everything, but there's no action until all of a sudden there's somebody interested in buying the property. I don't understand, how that works. Could you explain that?
Sure. There are a lot of sites that have had leaks over the years. It wasn't considered. People didn't really know what they were doing in those days, that some of these small leaks were going to have such large consequences. So the process for us finding out about them is sometimes long. We found out about this case in around about 2007. So there's a chunk of years if indeed it was known to have leaked in 1970. Some cases we find out about much quicker, as in when it's impacting someone's well and they're concerned about it. In this case, because there hasn't been any well impacted or any obvious effects, it's taken a little while for it to get in front of the regulatory agencies, and that's not atypical. If we knew about them all today, we'd be smart. So, one way to think about it is that maybe it's a good thing they're not all showing up at once.
So you're saying that the document that's recorded on your site that says it was first noticed in January of 1970 is false, or what?
I'm sure that's true, but whoever noticed it didn't let us know about it.
I'm not aware of any documentation identifying 1970.
That's what they look on your geologic site or whatever it is. The Resources Control Board, it's got one of the first documents is January 1970. And this is why I'm questioning, if it was.
We can't see that website, so we don't know exactly what document you're talking about. If you want to give your name to Kent, he could get back to you tomorrow.
I have a few questions. As I mentioned before, I am resident of Casa Marinwood. I am a breast cancer survivor. And around my house, more three people are diagnosed with cancer in the last 3 years. I'm glad that you can explain me a little bit more about the relationship with cancer at the park, and how we can request from you guys to have some sampling in our area.
Okay, I'll take the first part of the question. Usually, PCE, when we evaluate the toxicity, the first thing we look at is non-cancer toxicity, which affects the nervous system. People get dizzy and get headaches. But PCE also is thought to have some carcinogenic activity. So as you probably know by now, cancer doesn't come overnight. It comes over many years and many things contribute to it. Now, the thing with PCE is when it breaks down, it makes some other compounds. And some of these compounds that generate when it's broken down, they're actually known carcinogens. So while it's a good thing that this remediation is working because the PCE is going away, there's a time at which these carcinogenic compounds are in the soil vapor and groundwater. And so, yeah, I mean, since cancer is a process that has many factors that contribute, depending at which time you're exposed to and what other things are going on to, I mean, it can contribute. As toxicologists, we usually try to put a number on it. We talk about the list of excess cancer lists and their numbers, and it's like, I mean, we usually try to stop it at 1 in a million and things like that, but I mean, it's hard to say what it does. Now if you, in your neighborhood, if there are a lot of cancer cases, then, you may want to notify the Department of Health when things like that happen, that there are a lot of cancer cases, and so there can be an investigation done to see if it's a cancer cluster, whether it's statistically significant.
I understand. In an ordinary case, that is the way, but because we have here a probable reason, I don't say that it is or not, is can we request a sample from the area?
We normally require sampling to define the extent of the plume, and in this case, the soil pollution, the groundwater pollution. In this case, the pollution is moving off to the south, southeast.
Southeast.
And
sorry, it's a pan. Pan is
off. So the pollution plume has been defined, and it doesn't really extend into the neighborhood.
How do you know if you didn't
see the plume? We can go back to the graphics to show you how the plume has been defined. But there are samples that are non-detect on three sides of it, between the pollution and the homes. So that's why we have a fairly high degree of confidence that the pollution has not gone into the neighborhood.
How do you sample the creek?
The creek is a sample. The creek would be an unusual way for people to be exposed, though, because they'd have to be spending many hours a day at the creek to be exposed.
How about the airborne?
Airborne. Well, since it hasn't been found in the creek, we don't really expect to find it.
In the area.
Outdoor air concentrations tend to be very low compared to indoor air. They did find detectable levels in the liquor store because it was directly above that hot spot that Daniel showed you. But that's sort of a worst case. Once you go out into outdoor air, you have all that mixing that goes on, and so the concentrations are a lot lower. We don't normally require outdoor air testing. We require indoor air testing if indeed it's needed.
Do you mind,
at some point we have one more piece of the presentation, so if people have questions.
Just a quick question. When was PCE recognized as a dangerous chemical? What year?
I'm not sure that it was sort of a point in time. I think what happened is that evidence accumulated that it was having toxic effects, and at some point EPA started to list it, and states started to set standards for it. And that was probably going to be in the 70s, 80s. That's when all of the environmental legislation was going through.
Okay.
Here. As you say, if you could put this in perspective, what are the level of concentrations relative to your guidelines, the ESLs, or whatever you're going to be using as the cleanup criteria for this site?
Dan's the best person to talk about that.
I guess what would be helpful if we could just say order of magnitude. Is this 10 times more? Is it 100 times more in the hotspot areas?
In soil, let's see, roughly 10 to 20 times higher than the standards. Groundwater, the groundwater standards are actually lower proportionately, so that it's more like a factor of 100. But again, we now know that no one is drinking that water, so that's not a risk.
Yeah, that was based on the drinking water source.
Yeah. And soil vapor.
And it's about 10 times more.
In our little hotspot area, there are very high concentrations in the soil vapor. Very high. Three or four orders of magnitude higher than the soil vapor standards. But that's more of a symptom than a cause, unless you planted yourself with your head in the ground, you wouldn't be exposed to that at all.
Can I just add on to, you used the term ESLs, I'm not sure everybody knows what that means. It stands for environmental screening levels. And these are numbers that the Water Board has come up with, but if you're below those numbers in soil or soil gas or groundwater, there shouldn't be a problem. If you're over, you may still not have a problem, but you're going to have to take a closer look.
So, my understanding is that there's three contaminants, three types of contaminants in the soil. It's PCE, TCE, and I don't know, DCE. I don't know. They're all kind of similar, but there's more than one. Can you talk about what they are, what the risks are, and if there's something that we should particularly be concerned about with these chemicals being there and as construction on the site progresses?
That's kind of a multi-part question.
I know.
To start with the first question about the different chemicals, what they used in dry cleaning was PCE, and pretty much in the machine or in the dry cleaner, it stays that way. When it gets to the ground, bacteria get on it, and we start to see TCE, cis 1,2 dichloroethylene, vinyl chloride. Those are breakdown products. Some of those are less toxic than PCE. The vinyl chloride is actually more toxic. All of those chemicals are being treated simultaneously by the treatment process we have in place, or would be treated by excavation. When we do excavation, we would set up a perimeter and monitor air quality. We would have limits on wind velocity. If the wind kicks up too much, in particular if it's blowing west or south, we would stop work. That kind of thing. Just common sense stuff to minimize anything moving off site. We'd also, because of digging, there can kick up dust. We hose that down so we minimize dust. You shouldn't see dust, you shouldn't smell anything. It'll be a noisy operation, but there shouldn't be any health consequences to people around there from the work.
Yeah, I mean, this area gets really windy, and you're right next to a market and a school bus yard, and so, the dust is going to get around, and again, I mean, it's just part of construction and part of doing demolition and digging in the soil. So, as residents that shop at the market, that have our kids on the school buses, I'm just wondering, what should we be looking for? What are you going to ask? Not you, because you're on that.
If you see fugitive dust, you have that's obvious, but we won't generate dust. So that's just.
We'll end up submitting a work plan that explains how they propose to do the construction, and we could arrange to have the community review the work plan. We will make sure that the work plan covers things like dust, and under any construction scenario, whether it's contaminated site or not, emitting dust into the air is unacceptable to the air board. And if it gets out of control, then the operation has to shut down until the wind dies down. So we've seen redevelopment on a number of these kinds of contaminated cases, and you know, we're familiar with reviewing the work plans and making sure that the project accounts for the sensitive nature of the site. We've even, you know, required that monitors be set up at the perimeter of the construction area. So I think that when you have a chance to see a work plan, then you could review that with those questions and see if your concerns are better addressed.
Why don't we go on with the rest of the presentation and then have questions instead, because some of them might be answered when you finish your presentation.
Excellent idea.
Yeah, that's kind of what we wanted to do here. So Dan, could you take us back to that last slide showing the offsite work?
Maybe not.
Okay. there it is, okay. So as Dan talked about, what I want to do is just take a couple minutes and sort of wrap this up and show you and tell you a little bit about where we're going. Dan's done a really good job summarizing the work that's been done. The regional board has recently approved a work plan from Geologica to do exploration at each of the places where you see numbers there. There are several that are to the east of 101. There's also one over by the eastern hotspot there. And
did you point that up?
That would be
C1 here is by the eastern hotspot.
Right.
C2 is in the median.
Yeah, C2 is a place where there was a groundwater sampling done before. We're doing that to confirm the results that we saw there before. And C1, is, as Dan was pointing out, is being done to see how effective the treatment that they've done has been there. At some point, if it turns out that the treatment is not progressing the way that we hoped or expected, then as Dan pointed out, we may excavate that area because it's outside the building. It can be relatively easy to excavate that. The other hot spot that is underneath the building is planned to be excavated when the site is redeveloped. From what we hear from Bridge Housing, which is intending to purchase the site and redevelop it, that could be as long as 3 years. Depending on, again, on what we see with our groundwater sampling to the east of the freeway, we may initiate a different kind of treatment prior to that to try to cut off the groundwater plume that may exist. The sampling on the east side of the freeway is primarily designed to let us know how far the contamination groundwater has migrated and what concentrations might exist there. If we see concentrations there, then we may need to go farther to see how far the plume has gone. So, but that is what our intention is to make sure that before the site is redeveloped, the two hotspots are eliminated to the degree necessary to prevent health risk for unlimited use, which would include residential or any other use. So I think that there's probably some other good, really good questions, so I'm going to stop there.
Kent, do you want to talk about the RAP and the process for actually closing the site?
Yes, at some point we, well actually that's more of a process question, so I'm going to let Stephen talk about that.
Okay. So what's happened here at the site so far is investigation work and some what we call interim cleanup work. Normally, we want to see a cleanup plan that addresses all the problems that are at the site. That's called a remedial action plan, a RAP. Sometimes you'll hear it's a cleanup plan. That gets submitted, it gets put out for public comment. We either approve it or reject it, and then require its implementation once it's approved. After some period of time, when the contaminant levels get low enough, then the site would qualify for closure. We write that closure letter, and they'd be done. That's really the, how the back end of the process works. Any questions about that part?
But the RAP would go through a 30-day public comment period, and the document would be posted in the library and various places, so you'd get a chance to look at it and see what we propose to do. And there could be another meeting if that's desired to talk about the plan.
So right now you're saying there's not a set plan as to how to fully clean up the site?
That's correct.
Okay.
What we have all the ingredients, though. The site's been investigated. They've tried a couple of things. So now they're in a really good position to look at the alternatives and say, this is what we think should be done. We'll look at it. You guys will look at it, and we'll decide if it makes sense.
And whatever you guys do, will it have a period from the time of when you finish the cleanup, will there be a set amount of time before construction is allowed to start that will allow for monitoring to ensure that the entire area is fully taken care of?
Actually, the two things can happen in an overlapping fashion. Soil cleanup sometimes has to happen in concert with redevelopment, because once you slap a new building down, the soil is inaccessible. But a lot of the cleanup at these sites involves groundwater, and the things you do to clean up groundwater can be done during, after construction. Does that help?
It does, except for, so, but for the areas that are affected that are not groundwater, those need to be fully cleaned up prior to any type of construction and monitored before any construction is allowed to begin?
If there's soil being dug out, for instance, there will be confirmation samples taken to show that they got everything.
Okay.
Let me understand something. Who contact you with water? Is the owner of the building? Is contact you and contact them? How does that work?
We are the regulatory agency, so we are issuing directives, and the landowner is the one that's responsible for doing the cleanup. So they're the ones that hire the contractor and do the digging.
Oh, so they hire them.
Exactly. So we as a regulatory agency have sort of an arm's length relationship. We're not actually getting out the shovels, but we're telling them what needs to be done. Does that help? We have one question back here.
Hi, I was wondering, what prompted the initial investigation of the property, of the groundwater and soil in 2007?
In modern day times, pretty much whenever you do a commercial property transaction, the lender or the finance team will require environmental due diligence. Nobody wants to buy a property that turns out to have been a gas station back in the 30s or a dry cleaner in the 60s, et cetera, et cetera. So this was Home Depot was looking at the property, and the first thing they do is look around and say, what are the possible problems here? Asbestos tile, dry cleaner, gas station on the corner. There was a gas station there opposite the existing gas station. So all those things came up as things to look at.
Do you find that to be a detriment to the future development of housing there on that property?
Would it be easier to put housing or any structures on that property if this environmental problem wasn't there? Yeah.
I mean, I'm saying that since it was a gas station there, you have those concerns as well as dry cleaning concerns. Do you think that will halt or
it's not uncommon to redevelop what we call a brownfield site for residential purposes. It can be done. The regional board has developed environmental standards for residential use for that purpose.
Yeah, but
and different standards for commercial.
We would not like a neighbor here to have this building that they say you can have a lot of building around that say living here can cause the effect of blah, 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 blah. We don't want this kind of development.
Yeah, would that be...
Can I just interrupt there? We're really not going to be able to help you out on the land use question. We're not a land use agency. What we do is make sure that whatever happens on the site, existing use or future use, that it's health protective. That's our job. What was the question up here? Someone's been very patient in the front.
That's unusual, but No, so I just wanted to tie, make sure I'm tying it together in my head. And you were saying that the process began in around 2011.
2007 was when investigations began. Our treatment process was in 2011.
So in that, you were saying the way you were going about it then, because it was a down economy and not a prospective buyer, was a 3 to 5 year process, and that's sort of the track you've been on. So regardless of, like, let's say the buyer goes away and it's back to not having a buyer, would it still be in that 3 to 5 year mode, or would that depend upon what you find on the east side of the highway? I mean, I guess what I'm asking is everything contingent upon this prospective buyer, or there's other factors in play determining how quickly the ground cleanup will occur?
Well,
would you like me to take a step?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Well, in terms of, obviously, it's harder for the owner to pay for this cleanup work when there's not a buyer on the table. But as far as the regulatory process, I'll defer to Stephen on that.
The site does need to get cleaned up.
Okay.
So that'll happen one way or the other. Sometimes it happens quicker if there's redevelopment. Redevelopment provides us sort of the opportunity, the access. There's money on the table. So sometimes things do happen faster when there's redevelopment.
But a couple of questions. So, I mean, what if it takes 10 years for a buyer to come through? Are you going to just leave it sit for 10 years? Is there a...
He said 3 to 5 years.
It has to be gone within 3 to 5 years. So it's 2013, so by 2016 it should be clear.
Dan has given you an estimate for how long he thinks it will take. There's no regulatory requirement to clean up by a particular date. I think what would matter a lot is if there were people currently being exposed, if that were happening, the schedule would be very, very short.
Okay.
He has a bit more time now because no one's currently.
So I have one additional question, if I can ask it quick. So you're the state agency. What other regulatory bodies would be overlooking all this? Would it be the EPA? Is there anyone else except you guys as regulators?
Well, we try not to double team. So if the EPA is looking at a site, we usually don't, and vice versa. If we needed assistance on some special issue, let's say a habitat issue, we might go talk to our friends at the California Fish and Wildlife, for instance.
Okay.
I don't think that we're coordinating with any other agencies on this particular site. Okay. Question in the front.
I just have a question. Do you know if the sun is growing? Is it continuing to grow?
If the what's going?
The plume?
There's no evidence that it's growing. What we have on site is stable. Pardon?
Like, is there any evidence? If we haven't even tested the other side. If it's traveling, then it would be a concern as you get closer to Miller Creek, as you get closer to potentially closer to a well, that there would be some incentive to force the property owner to clean it up.
There's a phenomenon that happens when we do these stepwise investigations. When you take samples farther and farther away from the source area, we get data that can make the plume outline get bigger. But that doesn't mean that the plume is growing. That means that the data set is growing. So considering the time of the release and the nature of the geology here, and the fact that the source has been removed, the dry cleaner operation was stopped, there's no reason to think that the plume is continuing to grow bigger. There's every reason, based on a lot of professional experience here, that the plume is either stable or getting smaller. The unanswered question is, how far has it gotten? How far did it get before the dry cleaning operation was taken out? The soil under the two hotspots still represents an ongoing release. So the sooner that we can address the soil, that'll basically leave it so that the water would eventually clean itself up, but it probably wouldn't be fast enough to be meaningful.
So can you just so that we all understand, because I don't understand. So the contamination is in the soil that's then seeped into the groundwater. So if you take out the soil, then essentially you're stopping any further releases into the groundwater? Is that true? Or can you explain
we call that source removal. So one step in source removal is to take away the dry cleaning operation and the chemicals related to the dry cleaning. Another part of source removal is to define how much soil has been contaminated and remove as much of the contaminated soil as possible. So that's why we're eager to have the owner verify the success of the treatment outside the building. And if it's working, that's great. If it's not working as fast as Dan has estimated, then we'd like the owner to ramp it up, possibly consider excavation. And then, depending on the timing of the building construction, if the building is taken down, that'd be an excellent opportunity in a couple of years to remove that source. It looks like that's not going to happen, and it looks like this newest sampling phase indicates that if groundwater pollution is going across the freeway, then there's things that we can do in situ in the ground, under the ground, maybe along a similar line. We can put in sort of a chemical fence that reacts with the groundwater and cleans it up as it moves across there.
So,
in the back?
Mary, just a question there on this. Until the building's removed, you can get down and clean up the hot spot underneath the building. You really can't correct the problem. Is that what I'm understanding?
They could possibly drill through the floor and inject the same material that they've injected. They elected to cover the floor, but they could go through the floor again and inject material if it was needed. We tell the responsible entity what the target is, and they tell us how they propose to get to whatever the target is. We evaluate the timeliness, and we approve it or disapprove it.
What soil type for extraction looked at?
The superficial soils in this area are very fine grained. You could do SVE, but it'd be a slow and costly process. If we want to speed things up, excavation is really the fastest. If we have to get creative because the building's there, there are other in situ methods that work. But SVE is not a good candidate for this site just because of the clays and silts there.
So on the excavation, if that's about that happens, whether it's in relation to redevelopment or just cleaning up the mess, can you talk a little bit about, I understand you don't have a formal plan submitted, but can you talk a little bit about scoping and whether what protective factors would be in place given that there is an active, in a separate building-ish market that we all frequent? Given the school bus yard, given the dairy farm across the mm-hmm. road, are there any regulatory requirements of said landowner in relation to loss of business for said dairy farm or market during that remediation process? What does that look like?
Well, the excavation work itself is fairly quick. We'd be talking about on the order of a few weeks rather than years.
A lot for Marinwood Market.
It's unlikely we'd shut the market down.
Okay.
We would monitor air quality during the work, and we would be looking for these dry cleaning solvents. At these concentrations, there is not going to be that much kicking up in the air. They're not that high. We can dig slower. We can work on, not on a day like this, it's just common sense stuff. If the wind's blowing strong in a northerly direction towards the market, then maybe we don't dig that day.
So that will all be taken into
yeah.
be as
we'll put that in a plan, yeah, and mm-hmm. that will be put out for public comment. So that it's not a, it looks like, because we reduced to four bullets on a slide, like it's a boom, boom, boom thing. But actually, there's a lengthy process involved in doing anything at a site like this.
So if excavation needs to happen, is it just the hot spots that you would excavate, or would you excavate the soil vapor area as well?
The only place that we really exceed criteria and really are a source to soil vapor is the soil that has PC stuck to it. Mm-hmm. The plume is the mass of PC, and the vapor itself is very small in relation to what there is in the soil. Like the difference between a cup and a thimble. So there wouldn't be much benefit to digging up all the soil. It would just go away, and you release it to the air. You wouldn't be able to
If you remove the hot spots, eventually the soil vapor will go away because the hot spots are gone.
Yes.
And then the groundwater, you guys are able to treat through chemicals?
The groundwater may need to be treated through chemicals. It may be that enough source removal has been done that the natural factors in the ground will break the chemicals down and degrade naturally. That's something that will be evaluated for this final remediation action plan.
One more question, and it might be...
But then I think we need to defer to somebody else.
previously you had said that there's no, since there's no one living there right now, or that there's not... It sounded like there was less, there wasn't an urgency, but given that there's a liquor store that's right there, there are people that are interacting very closely or on top of.
But we're monitoring inside of the liquor store. And we test the air twice a year. The concentrations are at or below the state's criteria.
Okay.
So that's not an issue for the occupants, and your exposure going in there every once in a while is less than what you get just living next to the freeway, which is a source of benzene and other bad things.
Yeah.
Okay. I haven't heard from you. Better to speak.
I heard earlier that the depth of the contaminants could be down as far as 35 feet. So let's say there is a redevelopment project of some sort. They're going to go down 35, 40 feet until bedrock to do the excavation of the hot spots?
Typically, the impacted soil extends only to 10 or 12 feet. That would be the limit of our excavation.
Okay.
The groundwater is below that. And we don't usually dig groundwater. We might treat it or pump it or do something like that, but we won't dig it up.
Excavated and it's wetted down and put in the back of the truck sealed when they do the off-haul, or,
It's covered. As far as being sealed, no. But the amount of the PC and the vapor is so small, it's not going to get around. But that's what the monitoring is for.
So your criteria is more, don't talk about time, talk about health risk. What is less health risk? Biomedical remediation, or do the excavation. If we don't think about that we need to build something there, just what is more recommended for the health point of view?
Both of those methods can be health protective if they're done right.
I can see that the excavation can be more risky because you open.
Yeah, you probably need more precautions to be taken when you're doing soil excavation, because there is potential for vapor off-gassing, for dust. So that requires careful management and careful oversight by this board. We think both can be effective, and as you've heard already, soil excavation is a very direct and short way to solve the problem. So there are trade-offs all around.
I thought that it's not driving for the economic reason to build something and make money for it.
This is a money loser for the landowner. This is their money being spent to clean it up.
There was a question over there.
Yes, you've been very patient.
Is the gas station site clean, and were you involved in that at all?
The gas station on the Marinwood Plaza property.
Right.
Yeah, that was closed.
Right. The gas station at the northern end of the property was cleaned up and closed in about 1988, I understand. and there was, the cleanup was very thorough. They demolished the stations and they took the tanks out, and then they excavated soil around the tank locations. And later they came back in and they put in monitoring wells to look at the groundwater concentrations. And based on that, they saw some additional hot spots. They came back in and excavated again. The cleanup itself was very thorough. The other nice thing about the gas station as opposed to this dry cleaner is, as Dan was saying, dry cleaning solvent is a very persistent chemical, and it's difficult to clean up. And even though there are microorganisms in the soil that break it down, it's not as easy to break down as petroleum hydrocarbons like gasoline and oil. So given the length of time since the gas station was cleaned up, and the fact that the soil is very well aerated, I would expect that the concentrations of any petroleum in the ground there would be very, very low, almost non-detectable. So we're very comfortable that the cleanup of the gas station was complete and satisfactory.
Do you think there's any problem where the school buses are? An ongoing problem because of it being motor vehicles there or anything?
Well, that's something that we don't deal with. We don't deal with the motor vehicle part.
I don't know when buses are stored someplace. Do gasoline, does things get into the ground? That school bus site has been there for years.
It's not supposed to be getting into the ground. It's not a site that we have on our radar right now. And there haven't been any releases reported there. We don't have any information that there is a problem there.
Okay.
So if you know of a problem there, we'd like to know about it. Sir?
Yeah, I just wanted to ask you, on that point, I know when I talked to some of the Regional Property Control Board, they indicated that apparently the cleanup requirements had decreased in comparison to what the requirements were back when the gas station was remediated?
I think that you talked to me. State last year, our parent agency, there are 9 regional boards and 1 state board in Sacramento, and the state board in Sacramento adopted a policy for cleaning of underground storage tanks, and that policy is for all intents and purposes, not as stringent as some of the cleanups were previously. The allowable concentrations right now are a little bit greater than they used to be. And different people are working on these different cases, we try to be consistent, and some people are more strict than others as well. So. But that, based on my review of the case for the northern end of this property, it was very thorough cleanup. I'd be comfortable living there without any question.
Okay. So I was concerned about it when I think I discussed with you. It said that it should be deed restricted, not the residential use on the final report. And so that gave me pause with that conversation that I had with them.
Right. I'm not sure that person is long gone, and I'm not sure why there was nothing in the report to indicate why that property would be deed restricted, because it was very well cleaned up. So what will happen is when that site gets redeveloped, what we'll do as they redevelop is have them look for contaminated soil. And with petroleum contamination, it reacts with the soil and it tends to make the soil discolor. And so it's easy to pick up even at low concentrations. So, and the odor, of course, as it breaks down, as bacteria break it down, it gives off an odor, so it's very easy. And if we see stuff like that during the excavation, then that will be excavated and hauled off. But I doubt we're going to see that. Let's see. Thank you, Ken.
Yeah, what, enforcement mechanisms do you have should a property owner not do the cleanup correctly or doesn't have the money or just doesn't, it's just recalcitrant. What do you sue them? What do you guys do?
That's a question for Stephen.
The water boards have both civil and judicial remedies. For late reports, we can fine people administratively up to $1,000 a day per day violation. And if we sue them in court through the Attorney General, we can fine them up to $5,000 a day. Mm. That's usually a pretty good effective deterrent.
Well, sure. I just was wondering.
We want to make sure that the spending money on to comply is what they want to do rather than spending money on fines.
Mm-hmm. Is there any tie to your closure of the dry cleaner property to the property moving forward with development? Like, does the county require your sign off or closure before they will issue the permit for construction or demolition?
The short answer is no. They will sometimes ask us, is it safe? Will the future residents be safe? Are the contamination levels sufficiently low that these residents be protected? And we'll venture an opinion on that based on our judgment. But sometimes the cleanup is just going to take longer than the redevelopment will allow. So it's oftentimes two things happen in parallel.
There's a question over here by the door.
Yes. C3 through C9, you're going to do those this fall. And when will you have the results? And can we have another meeting to hear about those results and an update on what the status is, what you're going to do?
Well, Dan can tell you. Dan's from Geologica is going to be doing the work, and Dan can tell you about the timing of that. And then in terms of the results, what we'd like you to do is to, if you'd like to get information from us about what's going on, if you'd like to leave us your email address, we will certainly email you, and we can certainly consider having another meeting.
We can send snail mail, too. If you don't have email, you're still our friend.
Well, I do have email. I've just found your presentation to be very informative, yes. Very helpful, yeah. More so than my reading a lot of very technical stuff, which I did do and was completely over my head.
What we would expect to do is issue another fact sheet that we think is
reliable.
So we would issue a fact sheet that simplifies the results that he would put in his report. And we could issue the fact sheet, and if there's questions, additional questions, we would ask if there's a desire for a meeting. We certainly hear tonight that you're interested in convening a meeting again in the future. We'll take that in consideration, and then we'll probably ask you to emphasize that request after the information is available.
Uh-huh. I feel like you mentioned before.
I just wanted to follow up. Certainly, when we get close to these big decision points about what we're going to do to clean the site up. How clean is the site going to be when it's cleared for redevelopment, whatever that might be. At those points, that would certainly be a good time for me. We'll certainly do that. So.
Well, I'm interested in also in those borings that you're going to do.
Sure.
I mean, what the result is.
We truthfully, we probably won't be able to have another meeting right away. We can do a fact sheet. There's a lot of, as you might guess, a lot of planning and effort that goes into the meeting. And we talked about how long it takes to clean up the site. Part of that is that we have limited staff, and I myself have 25
well,
sites.
January so, or February of 2014 so, is.
Well, we want to get the data to you much sooner than that.
Oh, yeah, but to have another meeting.
Sure. Well, we can try.
My schedule's pretty open in January.
What's that?
My schedule's pretty open in January.
I know that you already mentioned, but I didn't get it yet. How the development with Bridge is linked with your zone today, if you say it is okay to build or not, the residents there.
It's not okay to build there today.
Okay, so when it will be the time that is bridge waiting for you guys?
No, as Stephen was saying, this is a process that's going to occur concurrently in parallel. We've got two problematic areas, eastern hotspot there along the fence and the hotspot under the building. The hotspot along the fence, we're going to deal with before the redevelopment occurs, whether that is doing more addition of chemicals or whether it's digging or whatnot. We'll probably deal with that ahead of the redevelopment process. From what the bridge tells us, it's going to be about 3 years before they break ground there. We had a meeting with the county and the bridge a couple months ago, and that's what the bridge was telling us. If it's, as we alluded to earlier, if it turns out it's longer than that, we'll probably have to do something ahead of the redevelopment, because more than 3 years is too long really to wait. And that would involve something like more injections or some sort of what they call a reaction wall, where they dig a trench and they put chemicals in the trench that, as the groundwater moves through, it reacts with it. What we'd like to do is have the building come down and excavate, because that provides a very definitive way to get that contaminated soil out. And we know, because when they dig the hole, they use sampling devices and they go around the perimeter of the hole, they take soil samples, and they send those to the laboratory, and those samples come back, and you say, okay, most of these are good, but this one over here is still too high, and dig a little bit more there, and then they say, this is why Dan was saying it might take a couple weeks, is because it can't happen all at once. We dig as much as we, based on the information that they have already, they would plan to dig that, and then they would use meters and devices in the field to try to determine what soil is contaminated, and then they would take these actual soil samples and they go to the lab. And those would be our confirmation samples. And those are what we based our decision on. So we're not going to be happy with unrestricted development there unless it's safe to do that.
So when is the earliest time you can give that report to Bridge? Yes or no for development?
We can give a report to Bridge. The way the process works is that, as Mary Rose was saying earlier, what we do is we tell Bridge, and Dan knows what these. Dan works on this site and he works on many other sites as well. He knows what the standards are that need to be met, and we would simply send a letter to Bridge. Actually, to the property owner is the party that we're dealing with. Bridge is the prospective purchaser, but there may be another purchaser before this is all done, so we don't know.
So when is the earliest time you would know?
Well, we're going to start working on the eastern hotspot. As soon as we get the information back from this work here in the next month or two, we'll know whether the interim remedial measures that on the eastern hotspot are working effectively. And if they are, then that's great. If they need a little push, we can do that. If they're not, then we may consider doing excavation there or some other means to go after that. The groundwater samples that we're going to take east of the freeway will tell us how much contamination is actually leaving the site. And that will help us determine whether we need to go after that area underneath the building before the redevelopment would occur and the building would come down. So it's an interlinked process, and we need additional information before we can give you a real answer to that. But realistically, a couple years anyway, because it takes a long time for the bacteria to act on this stuff. And that's another reason why we like excavation, because it's quick and it's very effective.
With PCE, is there a visible discoloration in soil or something that helps to identify? No.
Typically, no. Not like
gas and
not like
petroleum.
It reacts.
Isn't that thing you will prefer if you are exposed or not?
The PCE plate. You're asking, is there a test for humans? Is there a test for humans to see if you get exposed to PCE?
No, I don't think there's a test if you are exposed to low levels. Now, if it's levels that have some health effects, I mean, the first things you would feel, I mean, it's a lung irritant, so it irritates the lungs. You may have a cough, I mean, a headache. It may affect balance and things like that. There have even been people abusing PCE because everyone is different. Some people get a euphoric feeling from it. So that's just the effects of PCE on the central nervous system. And if it's really high concentrations and toxic, then it affects the liver. And then, a blood test for liver enzymes can show some abnormal levels of certain liver enzymes. So those are. So that's how one can tell one has been exposed to PCE.
Are there people from the report store monitor for something? They're talking about the report store. Is it there, born there?
Are we monitoring those folks?
Yes.
No, because the work that Geologica has done has brought the concentrations down to the point where they're not problematic. Without what they did is they modified the air conditioning system by putting in additional fans to move more air through, and they also sealed the floor, so the vapors are not coming into the liquor store as they once were before those measures were taken. So as a customer, you have nothing to
do with that at all.
The workers are not exposed to increased risk because of those measures. Without those measures, it would be problematic, yes.
Okay.
More questions?
I've attended a lot of meetings in the last, I don't know how many months, and this is one of the best meetings I've ever been to, because you people know what you're talking about, and you're willing to explain it to us, and you're willing to answer all our questions, and I just think this was great.
Thank you.
To end on, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of you, unless there's any more comments or questions. I'd like to thank you for coming, spending your time, giving us your questions, listening to our answers. I want to thank Steve for opening the meeting. We did organize the meeting. We reorganized the meeting in response to requests from certain members. Steve opened it to explain we're not here to talk about land use issues. We got a lot of help from the community center.
Yes, that's something I wanted to do specifically, is thank the staff of the community center. These guys have been great. They really helped me a lot. They're very, very flexible, and they really understand what their role as a community center is. My contact information is on the back sheet, so if you think of any other questions, please give me a question.
How are you in this scheme of things?
The dots on the map, are they like geolocated, or are they just like all over? I was wondering, they look like very precise locations, and do you geolocate all of your ores, or does it happen?
The monitor is surveyed.
Oh, wow.
Boring, I'll have to do with tape.